Thank you very much for attending this presentation on entangled photon communication and photonic router. What it is, it is a process to communicate regular bits using entangled photons. So let me explain how it works. So here we have on the top an entangled photon emitter, which is sending pairs of entangled photons to A and B. And as you will notice, A is a bit closer to the photon emitter than B, including the little device, which is a photon demultiplier. What happens is that here the information will be transmitted from A to B. So the first photon, photon arriving in A, gets coded according to its polarization with its angle and its ellipticity. So of course, because it's a photon, we can't say which angle you're going to be detected at, but we can say it's going to be this angle or this angle plus 90 degrees. So to do that, we get the photon to go through linear optics devices. So we first rotate the photon. Then we go with the Pockel cells. You see, for instance, the photon comes in with a vertical polarization. We rotate the photon with the rotator according to the angle we want. And then we go through Pockel cells to imprint a phase, the phase that we want as well. And then we measure the photon with two orthogonal photon detectors. So now the photon in A is coded. In fact, because the photons were entangled, the photon is B is encoded as well, and the photon is B is arriving to a photo demultiplier, which is typically an erbium-doped light amplifier, before its polarization is analyzed using classical devices such as interferometers and polarization filters. So up to now we have transmitted one letter. But the thing is that we live in the real world, and of course a lot of photons get lost while traveling from the photon emitter. So when a photon is lost while traveling to A and its sister photon arriving in B is not lost, the thing is that it will be polarized in a random way according to where it was lost, the way it was lost. However, statistically, a lot more photons will arrive in B coded as they were in A. So what we do is that we set two numbers. First, a number of photons we watch arriving one after the other, and then a trigger number. We say if we see so many, let's say six photons over 100 successive photons arriving with the same code, then we know that this is this code that was transmitted. And we can achieve that with a good probability. Let's say with a 90% loss over the line, if you watch for 100 arriving photons, the optimal number is photons to watch is 6, according to one chance in a million to get the code wrong. The system is fast because the photon coded in A immediately changes the polarization of a photon traveling to B because the photons are entangled. And the photons are coded while they are already far apart. Now we add on a security layer, a bit similar to QKD, to make sure that the message hasn't been listened to. What happens is that if some people try to capture some photons traveling to B, or just to copy some of these photons, then there will be either less photons arriving in B, either the quality of entanglement will have decreased, and therefore we won't be able to decode the message. now we have to care for the man in the middle process, or in fact, as you know, because you can't follow the line, you may have somebody else using the same system and intercepting your message. So to go against that, what we do is that we have a surveillance box close to B, where we make sure that the photon arrives in A before it has in B, sorry, before it has been coded in A, and still, of course, entangled to it. And if the photon is not entangled with A, in fact, it will arrive late. And so, by checking the time of arrival in B, we know that the photon will have not arrived in entangled. So now the photon arrives with the correct entangled to A in B. And what we do is that we compare the exact polarizations of the photons as measured in B for these photons, which these six photons, which did transmit the code. And we compare that with what was received in A. So we exchange a message. We could use the same technology, and we send the message. What we use is that we need to use a quantum safe message, otherwise anyone having a quantum computer can in fact put a man in the middle. So for that, we use what we call our random hash signature, where in the message where we put a secret shared between A and B in the message that we transmit. Here the message of arrival times and polarizations. So we put a secret number, and then we encrypt the signature, the hash, with a one-time key. And this technology can be used for physical links with optical fiber. Here, with 200 kilometers with a photon emitter in the middle, you can transmit data with 90% loss, and as I explained before, it should work quite well. Or you can use free space if you can have your photon emitter shooting photons at 500 kilometers away. You can transmit information quite far away. Now we have come up with a photonic router because this technology is very nice, but so far can only be used peer-to-peer, one-to-one. So here we have one router that can connect multiple terminals, properly equipped, of course, and the connection is made only with one optical fiber between each terminal and the router. Of course, the terminal can be a PC or a computer. How does it work? That we transmit, we have different colors for the photons, and we choose the color of the photon depending on the recipient we want to send the photo to. So here you have three different colors, and you see if you send a blue photon here with the top computer, you will get the photon sent to a separate blue fiber, sending the photon to the second computer. In fact, what you have in the boxes are demultiplexers. So the demultiplexer will separate the trajectory of the photons depending on their colors. And these demultiplexers are linked together with fibers. So application scenarios of this technology, well, you can leverage on your optical fiber network. There is, for instance, a QKD network in London that has been built in London, which could be used for that, probably. You can build a 600 worldwide ground cover satellite with 600 satellites at 500 kilometers altitude. And you can link distant CPUs. That's it.
Great, thank you for a very nice talk. If there are questions for the speaker, we have some time. Yes?
About the photo detectors. at different wavelengths, you're going to have to worry about different kinds of photodetectors.
Yeah. Well, you can do that with using the demultiplexers again. So you have a photodetector adapted to each the different wavelengths. And all of the signals being merged into a single fiber with a demultiplexer.
Some of them will be cryogenic and some of them will not necessarily, depending on the wavelength.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You can also use some wavelength converters, as I explained the person just before from the FRL.